So we have been looking at linear perturbation models, which are developed from mechanistic models by linearization. So you have a good mechanistic model, you want to use it for control. We have chosen an operating point where we want to control the system, linearized the differential equation, discretized them, and come up with a discrete state space model. We may not know a first principle model accurately. In that case, I said, well, you probably know at least the structure of the linearized matrices, and then you can identify elements, some kind of an optimization problem. And the structure is known a priori for simple systems. You can come up with this structure by arguing from your, you know, engineering knowledge about the process. So the system has some 3 or 4 states and 2 inputs, 2 outputs, or 3 inputs, 3 outputs, 3 measurements. Simple systems, you can argue from physics. A very complex system, it becomes difficult to, with lot of feedback loops, it becomes very difficult to come up with a structure which is. Anyway, the other problem we said is that we are just looking at deterministic effects. What about stochastic effect? What about effects which are disturbances which are unmeasured, which are not exactly quantifiable through a first principle model? How do you model them? And I said the possible remedy is a black box model. So in conclusion, before I move on to next part, I will just say that a reliable mechanistic model is available, then one can always linearize, develop a perturbation model, and use it for further controller synthesis. If you don't know all the parameters, if you just know the structure, you can develop perturbation model from data. Now I want to move to this new topic. The new topic is estimation of models directly from data without knowing any structure. Okay, so I am going to call it completely black box model, and the analogy I gave is to a correlation. Okay, so when we fit correlations, we are actually not using any physics. We are just saying that this is a dependent variable, this is an independent variable, they are correlated through some polynomial. Likewise, I am going to say measurements are dependent variables, inputs are independent variables, and they are correlated through a differential equation or a difference equation. What is the difference equation is what I want to find out. Okay. Before I move on to that, I need to do a lot of preparation. One of them is to say a few things about stability. Okay. So I am just going to do a quick review of stability of linear dynamic systems. I am going to revisit this again after some time. But here, this concept, one particular concept I need when I move to these time series models, and that is why I need to quickly review some concepts. That now all of you have done first course in control, right? What is the condition for stability? If you are given a transfer function, roots of the denominator polynomial is what influences the behavior of the solutions. And then what is so powerful about transfer function idea is that just look at the roots and you can say how the things are going to behave asymptotically. You just look at, you know, roots and say that if they have negative real part, you know, you will get asymptotically stable behavior. If you have one of the roots which is on the right half plane in the S plane, you have trouble, the solutions will go to infinity. And well, there are marginally stable systems. What are the marginally stable systems? On the imaginary axis, this all of you know about this. I just want to quickly review this, connect it with what we have done just now, state space models. And then I also want to relate this to discrete time models, because some stability ideas we need as we move on to. And as I said, after I am done with modeling, I am going to revisit the concept of stability again, because it's it's a central concept to control. Okay, so this is what I'm going to do, the very quick review of stability ideas. Now you consider a single input, single output system. CISO is single input and single output, one measurement, one input, simple system. Okay, we know that the transfer function for a single input, single output system will be given by some numerator polynomial. See here, I have this numerator polynomial by denominator polynomial, and I want to relate this to this state space model. We developed a linearized state space model, if you remember, right? So X here are the perturbations in the states. A is the coupling matrix, B is the input coupling matrix, A is the coupling matrix with the current states that bring in the information about the past. And what is the relationship between this state space model and transfer function model? I have just given here on the right hand side. The state space model is related to the transfer function through C into SI minus A inverse B. Okay, I have just rewritten this as C into adjoint of SI minus A cofactor transpose, right, into B. This is the numerator. This will be a single polynomial. Why it is a single polynomial? You have one output, one input. Okay, what will be the denominator polynomial? The denominator polynomial will be determinant of SI minus A. Okay, so if I have a transfer function relating Y and U, okay, roots of denominator polynomial is nothing but eigenvalues of, do you see that? What is determinant of SI minus A equal to 0? Roots of the characteristic polynomial, which is same as eigenvalues of, okay, which is same as eigenvalues of matrix A. So the roots of DS, denominator polynomial, which is same as eigenvalues of matrix A, okay, which is same as eigenvalues of matrix A, they determine how the solution YT behaves asymptotically. Everyone agrees with me on this? Right? Okay. Let us quickly review what we know. What is the first case? One case is that all of you said this, that if the roots have negative real part, the roots can be complex, eigenvalues can be complex, roots can be complex. Okay. So we have to work in complex S plane and we have to locate where the roots are lying. If the roots are real, okay, you may have, and negative, you will have exponential decays. If you have roots which are negative but complex, negative real part but complex, you will have oscillatory decays. All of this you have studied in your first course in control. Okay, so first thing is, of course, if the roots are in strictly left off plane or LHP off, then the transient of the system are asymptotically stable. Well, what if some roots are on the imaginary axis? Call it a marginally stable system. System may have transients which never die but which never grow. Okay, so you have bounded transients. Okay, so such systems are called as marginally stable systems. And this, of course, you know that if any one of the roots is on the right half plane, you have trouble. Okay, please keep in mind, this is analysis of a linear perturbation model. Linear perturbation model is an approximation in neighborhood of some operating point. Okay, when I am saying here that the solutions go to infinity, doesn't mean unstability actually of a linear system tells you that the solution will go to infinity. In reality, this is not going to happen. All it means is that a system has a tendency not to stay at that point, run away from that point. That's how we should interpret. Take this going to infinity with a pinch of salt. So unstable means, you know, it's like the pendulum. A pendulum, you know, has a stable state if it is, you know, if a pendulum is moving like this, there is a stable state here. But talk about inverted pendulum. Okay, inverted pendulum, this is an unstable state. You try to perturb it from this, it will try to go to the next stable state. Okay. It's not, the solution truly doesn't go to infinity. What it means is that locally the solution has tendency to move away from that point. Okay. If you perfectly are at that point, you will stay at that point, but which is very difficult. Okay. What is analog of this when you come to discrete time systems? Okay. Now, well, some of you probably have done this course on discrete time systems. For them, it's just a quick review. Now, just consider a CISO discrete time linear perturbation model. Okay. We have done this already, right? We have seen that this state space model, which is actually discretized from the continuous time model, okay, is equivalent to this transfer function here. Okay, can you say something by analogy now? What would determine the dynamic behavior? Determinant of okay, determinant of zi minus phi, which is the denominator polynomial. Okay, roots of this denominator polynomial will determine how asymptotic behavior of this dynamic system is. Okay, so this is right now purely by analogy. I'll try to give you logic why this is happening. Okay, so just if I draw analogy, then I should just look at the roots of the denominator polynomial. Okay, let's try to see why dynamics is governed by eigenvalues of. So what does govern the eigenvalues of the system? What governs the stability of? Okay, so how do eigenvalues of phi influence the dynamic behavior? Okay, so let's look at a scenario. I am looking at a scenario where x naught initial state is not equal to 0, but the inputs are 0. Okay, let's look at a simple, very very simple scenario. All the inputs from time 0 to infinity are 0. Okay, initial state is not equal to 0. Okay, it's saying I have a model for a pendulum. Okay, 0 means this stable state. Okay, perturbed state means you are here. Okay, so I am now looking at a system which is perturbed. Okay, and then how is it going to progress in time? Okay, is it going to go and die, or the oscillations are going to grow? Okay, that's what I'm interested in knowing. Okay, so or let's go back to our quadruple tang. Okay, you have a scenario that there is some the system was perfectly at steady state. Okay, the system was perfectly at steady state, and then somehow for some reason, no, the inputs are constant. For some reason, the levels are perturbed from the initial steady state. Okay, I am holding the inputs constant. Somehow the levels have become perturbed from the initial steady state. Question is, okay, if you are perturbed from the initial steady state, will you return to the steady state? Okay, or will you go away from the steady state? Okay, so that is governed by eigenvalues of phi. Why is it governed by eigenvalues of phi? Now, see, look at the model here. I'm starting with time 0. X naught is the initial state, which is non-zero. What will be at time 1, sampling time 1? Phi times X naught, right? What will be at sampling time 2? Phi times X1, which is actually phi square times X naught. Okay, likewise, if you just write these equations, you can very easily show that at any time instant k,
okay, the state at time instant k is phi to the power k x naught. Solution of linear difference equation. Okay, I am just recursively solving, substituting one after another. I'll get phi to the power. Is everyone with me on this? Phi to the power k. Okay. So now we have to understand how does phi to power k behave. Okay. Now I'm looking at this here. Let's look at a special case right now. Well, general case, of course. A slight modification, the same idea works. Let's take a special case where phi is diagonalizable. What do you mean by phi is diagonalizable? Eigenvectors are linearly independent. Okay, eigenvectors are linearly independent. Okay, so I can write my phi as psi lambda psi inverse. This we have done earlier, right? And then phi square becomes psi lambda square psi inverse, phi to the power k becomes psi lambda to power k psi inverse, right? So these are linear difference equations. Well, if you have done stability analysis in course on numerical methods, now we have done this in numerical methods. We had a similar equation, except in time we had iteration index, right? And we were analyzing error of iterative systems. We had exactly same equation. Okay, so what is lambda to the power k? Lambda to the power k, lambda is a diagonal matrix. Okay, so lambda to the power k is simply lambda 1 to power k, lambda 2 to power k, lambda 3 to power k. So what is going to really, see, psi is not going to change. Once you decide the eigen directions, psi and psi inverse are constant. Once you choose eigen directions or eigenvectors, these two matrices, psi and psi inverse, they remain constant. So as k, as time progresses, what changes? Lambda to the power k, right? Lambda to the power k changes as time progresses. Okay, so now first case is that, you know, all the roots of the denominator polynomial, okay, are strictly inside unit circle, okay, are strictly inside the unit circle in the complex plane. What happens if lambda is strictly less than 1? If is less than 1, lambda to power k, as k goes to infinity, see, if my lambda is mod lambda is strictly less than 1, then what I know is lambda square, lambda cube, progressively this will go to 0 as, okay. So lambda to power k will tend to 0 as k goes to infinity. Okay, lambda to power k will go to, now what will happen if all the eigenvalues are inside the unit circle? What is the unit circle? Actually, I am looking at z plane, complex z plane, and I am looking at this unit circle. Okay, so this is plus 1, this is minus 1, this is plus 1, this is minus 1, okay, this is the unit circle. If lambda is lying somewhere here or here or here or here or here or here, wherever, if it is inside the unit circle, lambda is a number lying inside the unit circle, lambda to power k is always going to diminish as k increases, okay. Is always going to diminish as k increases. Okay, so what happens? Lambda to power k is going to go to 0 as k goes to infinity. So which means matrix lambda to power k is going to go to 0. Null matrix is going to go to null matrix as time goes to infinity. Well, which means phi to the power k is go to 10 to null matrix as time goes to infinity. Okay. So, if my system is asymptotically stable, that is, if consider a four tank, I am just perturbed from the initial point, my inputs are constant. Okay. The system is asymptotically stable if all eigenvalues of the discrete time model are inside the unit circle, then you know the levels are going to decay and settle at original steady state. Okay. They are going to settle at the original steady state. This will happen provided all the eigenvalues of matrix phi are inside unit circle in the complex Z plane. Okay. So this is very, very critical. Such a system we will call as asymptotically stable system. So what is an equivalent, what is an equivalent stability condition for a Z transfer function? The roots of the denominator polynomial, if it is a transfer function, it should be inside unit circle in the Z plane, or for a discrete time state space model, eigenvalues of phi should be inside unit circle. Two things are one and the same, because transfer function is only a representation in Z domain. State space model is representation in time domain. Okay. So, what eigenvalues convey you there in time domain, same thing is conveyed to you by the roots of dz, okay, in the Z domain. Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah, thanks for this correction. So phi to phi k, which is phi to power k times x naught, okay, phi to power k times x naught, this will tend to okay, this is the phi to the power k x naught will tend to 0 vector, okay, and the perturbations will die. So the stability is decided by roots of the characteristic equation or roots of the denominator polynomial, okay, which is same as eigenvalues of matrix phi. Okay, you have to look at the relative location. See, the same power which you have in continuous time, what is the power of analysis in the continuous time? Just look at the eigenvalues, you can say how it is going to behave. Same thing is here, just look at the eigenvalues of phi or look at the eigenvalue of the denominator polynomial, it will tell you how the dynamic system is going to behave asymptotically. Okay, as time goes to infinity, how will the system behave? Okay, now what if you know you have a scenario where eigenvalue is located here or it's located here somewhere outside. If it is 1.0001, okay, if it is 1.001, suppose lambda is equal to 1.0001, then lambda to the power k will go to infinity as k goes to infinity. Okay, even if the value is slightly greater than 1, okay, that to the power k will go to infinity. So the solution will diverge. Okay, the solution will diverge even if one eigenvalue is outside unit circle. What about if the eigenvalue is on the unit circle? It will neither diverge nor converge, it will be bounded, the system is marginally stable. Okay, so equivalent to the continuous time case, now we have result which talks about a discrete time case stability. Okay, roots of the denominator polynomial, if you have a transfer function, look at eigenvalues of phi if you have a state space model. The relative location inside unit circle or outside unit circle or on the unit circle will tell you how is the dynamic system behaving. Okay. Okay, let me just quickly do one more thing. What is the relationship between a pole in the continuous time? What is a pole? Roots of the denominator polynomial in, well, we calculated different terminology. We call it poles. Okay. But they are nothing but roots of the denominator polynomial. Okay. Which are eigenvalues of a phi matrix or A matrix or whatever the case may be. Now we are looking at continuous time pole. So suppose you have this A matrix which is coming from a continuous time system and its eigenvalues are lambda I equal to 1, 2, n. Okay. And you have this matrix phi, let's call its eigenvalues as mu I goes from 1 to n. Okay. What is the relationship between eigenvalues of A and eigenvalues of phi? Okay. First of all, you should understand one thing. If your original system is stable in continuous time, it will be stable in discrete time. Stability, asymptotic behavior of solutions is a fundamental property. That's not going to change because you change, you know, from a differential equation to a difference equation. Okay. If a system is stable, it is stable. If it is unstable, it is unstable. Okay. That is not going to be changing because of change in the, you know, mathematical description of the system. Continuous time, discrete time, these are mathematical convenient descriptions under a different context. In the computer control systems, we use discrete time representation. That's why it is convenient to work with. Okay. So the relationship between this is mu I is exponential lambda I t, where t is sampling time, sampling interval. Okay. Now, how does this relate to the stability aspect? See, my lambda I, let's say, is equal to alpha I plus j beta I. Say, in general, a eigenvalue lambda I can be a complex. Okay. It can be complex. So, mu I is equal to e to the power alpha I t plus j beta I t. Everyone with me on this? Okay. So, which is equal to e alpha I t into cos Is that okay? Okay. So what can you say about this quantity? Modulus of this quantity is always bounded between plus or minus 1, sine and cos. Okay. It's never going to exceed plus or minus 1. Okay. So how does mu behave will be decided by, e to the power alpha I t. Okay. Do you agree with this? Okay. If alpha I is strictly less than 0, okay, alpha I is strictly less than 0, then e to the power alpha I t for any positive t, of course, any positive, sampling time is never going to be negative. Okay. You cannot sample with negative sampling time. You'll have to have sampling time positive. So if alpha I t is negative, e to the power alpha I t will be strictly less than 1, or mod of, actually e to the power alpha I will be positive number. I don't want to put mod. Will be strictly less than 1. Okay. And so what happens here is, you know, e to the power alpha I t into cos beta I t plus j sine beta I t mod of this is also strictly less than 1. Do you agree? Okay. So, a stable eigenvalue in continuous time maps to a stable eigenvalue in discrete time. Very, very important. Okay. Fundamental characteristics of stability doesn't change because you go from continuous time representation to discrete representation. Pardon me? Always true. Well, conversion, there is some problem because discrete time systems, there are some values for which there is no equivalent continuous time system. Okay. So, see, what if alpha I is equal to minus 0.5? You cannot find an equivalent continuous time representation on particularly, see, the trouble is here. You take this unit circle, okay, and what you can show, see, this is my z plane. Okay, and let's say this is my S plane. So what I am saying is that this left half plane, it actually maps inside the unit circle. The left half plane, entire left half plane maps inside the unit circle. Okay, but there is one problem. Problem in the sense that this line, this part, 0 to minus 1. Okay. There is a problem. You cannot find a continuous time analog which will map to a pole on 0 to minus 1. E to the power r t is never going to be minus, right? So rest of the plane will map everywhere except this segment. Okay. So if you have a discrete time system which has a pole here, you cannot find a continuous time analog. But so otherwise it maps inside here. This continuous time stable part maps inside here. Where does the imaginary axis map? See, this is the imaginary axis, this is the real axis, circle. The imaginary axis maps to the circle boundary. And where does the right half plane map? Outside the unit circle. Okay, if alpha I is greater than 0, then e to the power alpha I t is greater than 1. Okay, so this is just a brief review of stability of dynamical system. We'll visit stability again. Yeah. You cannot find an equivalent continuous time system which is. Yeah. On the right hand, on 0 to 1 there is no problem, 0 to minus 1 there is a problem. But complex time constant does not have meaning in the, you mean to say the complex ij will map into that line? Single will not, pair will. In continuous time, you cannot have a system which has a single time constant which is complex. If complex appears, it will appear in pair. So, 2 can map, but not 1. Okay. A pair can map, but single negative time constant mapping into a single is not possible. Okay. That is a trouble. Yeah. No, that cannot be said. The choice of different continuous time systems it depends upon actually that's a good question. Let's take a simple system which is tau s plus 1, okay. Oh, you are not. Let us take a simple system, transfer function. So, Gs is equal to tau s plus 1. So, this will map into a discrete time system, okay, where you know, the discrete time pole is e to the power minus t by tau. Okay, the discrete time pole of if you convert this into discrete time systems, you will get the pole of the discrete time system to be this. Now, this ratio t by tau, okay, can come from, see, this ratio can come from different systems. Okay, see, suppose this is 1 second and this is 10 seconds, the ratio will be 0.1. If this is 1 minute and this is 10 minutes, ratio will be 0.1. Okay, so multiple continuous time systems will map into same discrete time systems. The map is not unique. Okay, so when you go from, it's many to one map. So when you go from discrete time to continuous time, there can be infinite possibilities. If you have to fix something, if you fix, say, sampling time, then you get a unique. Okay, so the other way is very difficult to say. When you go from discrete time to continuous time, which is giving you this particular system. Okay, we'll have this kind of a thing in the exercises. So that's why I'm not doing it here on the board. So you will do it on the. Okay, so now we are ready to move into the next thing. Is everyone with me on this stability aspect? Okay, inside unit circle, outside unit circle. I'll be referring to this inside unit circle business throughout. Okay, because and you should not be confused. So now let's move on to progressively. The concepts are going to be fairly complex. Well, we'll. You keep asking doubts whenever you have problems, just stop me, okay, because till now whatever we did was okay, available. There are certain things which I am going to talk about, you know, are going to be fairly complex. I am going to talk about something called stochastic processes, and the maths will not be fairly complex. Conceptually it's fairly difficult to understand what we are going to do. And I don't expect that only these Python lectures, it's only sensitizing you. We are just touching tip of the iceberg. Eventually, if you keep working in this area, someday you will understand what all these things are. I am going to make my attempt to make it as simple as possible. Okay. Now we are getting into data-driven models. Okay, why data-driven models? Because, well, I don't know anything about the system. I have gone to some industry. I am given some plant. I can play with it. I can tweak. I can change some input. I can record outputs. Okay, just think of developing a control system for a car. Okay, you have been asked to develop a control system for a car, and you don't have mechanistic model for the car. Okay, it's not quite for the, I mean, you may have some mechanistic model for the car given in the literature, but that model and your car are different, right? You have, say, Maruti car, and then tomorrow you may have to work with Tata Indica, and so each one will have a different model. And developing a model for Suzuki will, let's say, take 1 year, then another year will go in developing it for Tata Indica. So it's not obvious that if you have this model, it will work there. Parameters are different, how it behaves is different, links are different, and so on. So you want to develop a quick model, not 1 year. You want to do it in, you know, 1 hour, and do it from data. So you might say, well, what is there? You know, fitting correlations. You measure input, measure output. Why are you worried so much? Well, the first problem is that I want a model of the car in dynamics, okay, while the car is moving. Now, what is the complication? What are the inputs? What are the manipulated variables in the car? Accelerator and brake, okay? And let's look at only one controlled output, speed. let's not worry about direction and all. Let's look at speed and motion in one line. We're going to deviate. Okay. Now, when a car runs on a track, okay, it's going to be subjected to drag because of the wind. You are not major wind. You can't afford to put wind measurement in your car. That's too much. Okay. So, but the winds are going to be, there are going to be gusts. There are going to be steady state condition, steady air, stagnant air condition. Then wind helping you, sometimes will help you, sometimes it will be in cross direction. You don't know. Okay. When you do an experiment, how the wind will behave? No idea. It's something which is outside your control. It's a disturbance. But when you collect data, let's say you put your pressure on the accelerator and you record data on the onboard computer. Okay. The speed that you get is going to be a complex function of your accelerator and wind. And there's one more disturbance, the track. Well, in our conditions, that's a big disturbance. Track can be suddenly very good, then suddenly, a pothole. And so, there are several problems which are, I'm going to call them as unknown disturbances. So the data which I get is always corrupted with unknown disturbances. Okay. Whatever I do, whatever experiments I do, there are always some unknown disturbances, okay, which will influence how the system dynamics behaves. And problem in developing models completely from data, black box models. We don't have any structure about coming from physics. Okay. Is in such a situation is this unmeasured disturbances. If the input that I give to the system, okay, if that is the only thing which influences the system, okay, great. You can model it very well. Okay. There are so many other influences, it's difficult to model. Okay. if I teach you and then I expect you should know something about dynamical systems. And then for that, I would expect that you study. But then you go to hostel, which is a big unmeasured disturbance for me. And, there are all kinds of attractions there. And it's difficult to model a system which has a lot of unmeasured disturbances. The second problem is when you are developing these models are approximate. Okay. We are developing a model for an unknown dynamical system which is subjected to unmeasured disturbances. Okay, we are going to make some assumptions. No, this is like a linear perturbation model. You know that really car is not a linear perturbation model. Car dynamics is very, very complex. Linear perturbation model is an approximation for your convenience because you can do mathematics very well. Okay, and if you want to control the speed in some small range, these models will be very good. Okay, so that's the assumption. So models are approximate. Okay, then there are unmeasured disturbances. As if that was not enough, the measurements are always corrupted with error. You never get perfect measurement. Okay, you have a transmitter. You convert signal from one to other, and finally you convert into some electrical signal which is connected to the computer. There are 100 different places where it can pick up some noise. Okay. Your data which you get, I'll show you some actual practical data. Temperature measurement in a beaker where the temperature of the water is perfectly constant. I put a thermocouple, I get data which is fluctuating. Temperature is not fluctuating, data is fluctuating because there are errors in the measurement. Okay, so there are two problems. Now we are going to develop a computer oriented model. I have freedom to do an experiment with the system. So this is my experiment. I'm going to inject in excitation. Okay. Inside my computer, I'm going to get a sequence of numbers, which is speed measurement. Okay. This is my, accelerator, the way I have played with the accelerator. And well, there are always unmeasured disturbances. The wind is not going to be in my control. Okay. Or the track conditions are not in my control. So, there are unmeasured disturbances unknown sources. We may not know even the source every time. Okay, and then the measurements are corrupted with noise. Okay, so the trouble is that if you want to get a model that relates this input with the output, then whether you like it or not, you have to model these disturbances. Now, it's a very strange thing. You have a disturbance which is not measured, which is not known to you, and still model it. Okay, looks formidable or in fact impossible. How can somebody model something which is not measurable? Okay, and the source is not known. How do I model that? Because there will be an approximation error which is cropping up because of linearization. Okay, so that also when you are actually developing models of this form, that also can be viewed as contributing to the unknown disturbance. It's a kind of a disturbance which is coming from approximation errors. Okay, so I would say there are three kinds of errors: approximation errors, okay, measurement errors, and actual physical inputs which are unknown. Okay, so the data which you get has all the three. I mean, data will not have approximation errors. Approximation errors start cropping when you start modeling. Okay, data will have only measurement errors, and okay, approximation error is something that crops up when you start modeling. So data will have unknown disturbances. Okay, so let's not get into what are the types. Let's look at a practical problem. Okay, so that now I'm going to look at a simpler system. I don't want to look at the quadruple tank. There are two inputs, two outputs. No, I just want to look at a simple system, two tanks, one placed above each other. Okay, and there are two control valves, control valve 1 and control valve 2. I'll show you a schematic diagram of this. Okay, this control valve 1 is used for manipulation. You pump in fluid in tank 2. It flows by gravity from tank 2, this tank 1 to tank 2, and then tank 2 to the sump here. Simple process. You can probably go to our undergraduate lab. This is undergraduate lab experiment in chemical engineering. Okay, so what we do is this second wall, we use it to introduce a disturbance if we want to. Okay, right now I am not going to introduce any disturbance. Okay, when I operate this system, this pump here is subjected to fluctuations in the power. There is enough disturbance already in the system. I am not worried right now about introducing another disturbance here. So I am going to look at the simplest possible case. This pump, this second pump, is this pump is off. Okay, this pump is off. Only I am pumping liquid through this control valve 1. Okay, what I am going to measure is this LT here is level transmitter. I am going to measure level. Okay, I don't have a mechanistic model for this system. I am just going to develop a model by doing perturbation studies. I am going to perturb the control valve position. I am going to record the level. Okay, I am going to record the level. I want a model that relates the perturbations in valve to, yeah, not pulse. I am giving sequence of pulses or sequence of steps. Actually, they are not, if you look at it, they are not really pulses. They are positive and negative steps. Now, why am I doing this? Why positive and negative steps? When I am linearizing a nonlinear model, okay, if you want to do an experiment, the behavior on the positive step and the behavior on the negative step is going to be different. If the behavior on the negative step and positive step is going to be different, okay, then I need an average behavior on both the sides. Okay, my operating point is 12 milliamps. Of, see, this control valve takes between 4 to 20 milliamps as the input. 12 milliamps are fixed, 50% opening. 12 milliamps is 50% opening. Okay, I am introducing a fluctuation. Okay, which goes between 10 milliamps to 14 milliamps, okay, about 2 out of 16, how many percent? 1 by 8, 15%, plus or minus 15%. Okay, I am introducing a fluctuation. Now, what is happening because of that? The level which was initially steady, the level that was initially steady, okay, it was steady at this particular 5.6 milliamps is some level corresponding to some level inside the tank. Okay, it started fluctuating. What is this fluctuation? These are the fluctuations recorded. Okay, this is the experiment I was allowed to do. Now, using this input and output data, single input, single output. Let's understand the simplest thing. Okay, we'll move to the complex things later. Single input, single output system. I want to use this data and come up with a model. Okay. If I change my operating condition, well, your question is important. It's not that I don't want to ignore your question, but the way I introduce positive and negative perturbations here, or fluctuations, you know, I have chosen the frequency of fluctuations very carefully. It is chosen in such a way that the plant is excited in the range in which it has a dominant frequency, okay, or close to the corner frequency. Okay, I don't want to excite it in very high frequency range where the system is never going to operate, or very, very low frequency which is of importance but which will get covered if I take a band. Okay, so how do you choose frequency of this excitation is an important issue, and but we'll postpone it. I'll briefly touch upon it at some point later, but how do you do this you need to go through some tests before actually. Average value of not 0 will be close to 12. Yeah, yeah. So if I do perturbation variable, what I have done here is next, I have, this is my absolute data, absolute values. Okay. I am subtracting the steady state here, I am subtracting this steady state here, and then I get perturbation data. The perturbation, the input. If you take a mean of the input, it might be close to 0. No, it did not be close to 0. Yeah, but if you keep doing this, then you will get a behavior which is fluctuating around some mean, original mean value. Provided, it will go to a new point provided the system is unstable or marginally stable. Okay. It will not go to a new point if the system is stable. Okay, this level tank is a stable system. Okay, if you increase the level inside the tank by gravity, the flow out increases. You know, so the level starts. So it's a self-governing or self it's an open loop stable system. Any other question? Yeah. Oh, you want to directly ask me? I'm right now in grade 1. You are asking me grade 10 question. Okay, not even grade 10. Actually, how do I model unstable point? My student is doing research on that. Okay, so it's a PhD question. So we are right now in first grade. Okay. No. This is a known input perturbation. Yeah, but then we assume that their fundamental, so how do I capture fundamental characteristics of the, you have a very good point, very intelligent question. Every time the disturbances will be different. Okay, I'm going to talk about it. Just wait. Okay. Okay. I think my animation, I forgot to put. Okay, let's just don't look at this down part. Look at the first thing. So what I have done now, I have collected the experimental data. Okay. I have set of inputs Y and measurements and U, which are known to me, which I have given. Now U here is what is going outside my computer, control computer. Y is the measurement that is coming to my computer. Okay. It's a computer oriented model. Sequence of numbers that has been collected as measurements and piecewise constant inputs that have been sent to the system. Okay. I want to develop a model that relates the current output. Okay. I want to develop a model that relates current output with past Y and past U. Why past Y and why past U? You have seen how dynamic systems behave. Okay. We have seen earlier how difference equations behave. In dynamical systems, current level will be function of past level and one level in the past inputs. We have seen this, right? That is the logic. I want to fit a difference equation. I want to fit a difference equation. Here I have put it in little abstract form. Okay. Now, I am going to look at this model. Okay, I am going to call this model as output error model, OE model. Okay, why it is called OE model? Because, okay, everything that is unknown is blamed to this error in the output. Y is the measured output. Okay, Y is the measured output. Okay, what is X here? How do you interpret X? X is the effect that is present in Y, which is coming from U alone, inputs alone. Is that clear? X here is a variable. Okay, X is a variable for which actually quantifies effect of U alone on Y. Okay. Whatever is the rest, okay, I am calling it as V here. Okay. This V here is the rest of the signal. So I am saying that the output signal consists of two subcomponents. What is first component? Effect of U alone. Okay. How is the effect of U coming through? It's coming through a transfer function GQ. Okay. Effect of inputs on the output is coming through a transfer function. Do I know this transfer function? I don't know this transfer function. What is the order? I have to guess. It's a black box model. I do not know whether it is first order or second order or third order or fourth order. I'm going to try fitting each one of them. Okay. And see which fits best. Okay. So the way I'm going to go about is by trial and error. I have data. Okay. I'll fit a first order model or a second order model or a third order model. Okay. And then see which one of them gives me good fit. Okay. And then decide. Yeah. Then decide. Okay. Yeah, that's a good way of saying it. X is the prediction, but not right now. Wait for it. We'll call it prediction a little later. Right now, X is a component, which is, there is a subtle difference between X and prediction. Okay, so just wait. Now, how do I choose this GQ? I have given some three options here. Can you see these options? Right now I have, see, earlier my GQ came from physics. Okay. from mechanistic model, some arguments. Now I don't know. Okay, so it could be anything that I choose. I have given three options. First option is a second order transfer function. The second option is third order transfer function. Then I have given one more option. Do you see that? What I have done is, I have done a long division. I have divided the, let's say take this case, I have divided the numerator by the denominator. And if I do that, I will get a model which is, you know, a series in Q to the power. You just do a division just like you do normal division of two polynomials. You can do polynomial divisions. And then you will get, and then you truncate the order. So you can get variety of models. We will look at the first one. Okay. I'll look at this model. How do I fit this first model? Okay. No. We have passed that stage. Now just don't talk about a good physical model is available. No. That's separate things. Don't confuse. Here, right now, I have no clue what the model should be. I have no clue of the parameters. I only have data. Okay? So I am just looking at fitting a transfer function into this data. Okay. So all that situation scenario is not valid. It's probably there in your research problem, but not here. Okay. Now let me make an argument that there are two tanks, so the model should look like second order. Okay. So I'm assuming that the model between X and U is second order. I'm neglecting wall dynamics. I'm neglecting sensor dynamics. So I'm saying there are two dominant capacitances. One is tank one, other is tank two. So my model should be like second order. Okay. A second order model is actually a second order difference equation. See here. Well, there is one more thing which I just want to add here. For this particular system, okay, we know that there is a time delay of one sample. Okay. So the model that I proposed here is actually second order model with one more time delay here. You see this time delay here? Okay. So if I convert this, second order model into a difference equation, I get this linear difference equation. Everyone with me on this? Linear difference equation? This is my model, which is proposed model. Okay. This is a proposed model. Not state. Yeah. Yes. No. There is always one unit time delay in any discrete time system. There is additional time delay which will give you 2 units of time delay. Okay. Any discrete time system, real discrete time systems, what you do now will have influence after one sample. Okay. Most of them. Okay. Yeah. Not assume. I have found in this particular system, experimentally I have found that there is one time delay. This is actually physical. I showed you the setup, no? This is our UG lab setup. So I have found that there is a unit time delay. Okay. So that's why I'm adding it. If I had found experimentally that there are two time delay equal to 10 seconds, right now sampling time I think is 5 seconds. If I have time delay equal to 10 seconds, I have taken D to the power minus 2. Okay. So time delay equal to 1 is an experimental finding. I have independently found that there is a unit time delay in addition to the time delay which is because of discretization. Discretization, see, you look at a discretization, x k plus 1 is function of u k. So there is always a unit time delay. Okay. Discretization process itself introduces a unit delay. In addition to that, there is one more delay here, which is, okay. Okay. Now I want to estimate model parameters. What are the model parameters? A1, A2, B1, B2, right? These are the 4 parameters I need to estimate. The trouble is, I don't know X. I only know Y. Y has, X is hidden inside Y, but I don't know what is the distribution between X and V. I have no clue. Okay. this cannot be measured. The contribution to Y, which is coming from U alone, cannot be measured. There is no way of measuring a separate, in the level, you cannot have two level transmitters, one which gives you only effect of U. That is not possible. Okay. So there is a fundamental problem. Vk is the unknown disturbance. Of course, unknown disturbance can never be measured. Okay. Unmeasured disturbance can never be measured. So now you have to do some kind of optimization and come up with okay. Now, if I am given a guess, okay, if I am given a guess, So what I am given, I have this model. Let's say you give me a guess. You give me a guess for A1, A2, B1, B2. Okay. I have no idea what is X1, X2. Okay. Like, we can make a simplifying assumption X1, X2 is 0 because you are starting from a steady state. Your data in which you started from a steady state. So the input was 0, effect of input on Y was 0 at time 0. We can make that simplifying assumption. Okay. But right now I am saying that you give me a guess for two initial points, x1, x2. Okay. If you give me guess for initial point x1, x2, a1, a2, b1, b2, I can predict. Okay. I can predict x3. This is prediction. Okay. Prediction is different from true x. Prediction of x is not equal to the true x. Okay. So this is my prediction. Is everyone with me on this? I know inputs. I know entire input sequence. U is known to me. Okay. Now you have given me A1, A2, B1, B2 and X1, X2. Given this information, I can use the difference equation in time, go progressively predicting. Okay. So if I predict X3 using X2, X3, I can predict X4. Right? Is this clear? I can predict X4 because I know U2, I know U1. Okay. Parameter guess has been given to me. Okay. I can just go on. Okay. From if you give me this 6 things, 4 parameters and 2 initial states, guesses for 2 initial states, I can just go on solving the difference equation. I mean, how will you do it in a program? Put a for loop, okay, and you go marching in time. You are just going marching in time. You go from x2 to x3, x3 to x4, x4 to x5, you just go marching in time. Okay, it is very simple. So, in general, I can go up to time n. Okay, okay, so this is where I begin. Well, then I move on to x4, which is function of U2 and U1 and x3, which was, so x3 was computed here, that is used here. Okay. You move on, you know, x3, x4 were computed here, they are used here. Okay. And U3, U2 are known to you. Okay. So you just go on doing predictions. These are predictions for the given guess. These may not be equal to the truth. They will be equal to the truth only when you have correct values of A1, A2, B1, B2. Well, in a real system, what is correct is difficult to answer. So, if I have all these predictions, I can also predict V. Right? I can predict V if I have predictions of X cap 2, X cap 3, X cap 4, X cap 5, I can predict V cap. I am not calling it V, I am calling it V cap because it's a prediction. It's an estimate, it's not the truth. Okay, that's why I am calling it V cap. Okay, now I am going to estimate these parameters through nonlinear optimization problem. Optimization is great thing. What Gauss did is invent this wonderful technique, and you know, all of us are in business. So You have to solve the problem through optimization. What I have to do is minimize some kind of an objective function. What I'm going to do is least square estimation. Okay? I want this Vk. Vk is, what is Vk? Vk is difference between y measured and x. What is x? Effect of input u alone. I want to have difference between y measured and x. Okay, as small as possible. How do I say this? Okay, I say this by putting an objective function. Sum of the square of Vk should be as small as possible. Well, why sum of the square? Why not absolute value? You can choose absolute value. If you choose square, problem is simple to solve, relatively. Okay, we work with two norm because, you know, there are many, many properties of two norm which you can exploit and come up with analytical expressions for, you know, understanding the behavior of optimization problem and so on. So two norm is very, very convenient mathematically. So this is an optimization problem in which, so what is optimizer going to do? Every time guess A1, A2, B1, B2, X1, X2, okay, and compute the objective function. If it is, you know, you have given some tolerance, if it is greater than the tolerance, it will, you know, take a new guess by a gradient search or whatever method, conjugate gradient or, you know, Newton's method, and then it will find a new guess. It will stop only when you get sum of the square of error minimized in some sense. Okay, so what I get after that is an estimate. You can choose, if you don't want to guess every time x1, x2, you are saying that you are starting from initial steady state, initial states are 0, that reduces the problem to only 4 guesses, a1, a2, b1, b2. Not an easy thing, how to guess a1, a2, b1, b2 for a discrete time system. If I do this using MATLAB system identification toolbox, I'm going to demonstrate this toolbox at some point. Then this is the model that I get. Okay, I get optimum values. These are estimates of A1, A2, B1, B2 for the two tank system which I showed you. How good is my model? Okay, look here. Plus, 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 plus are model predictions. Blue line is the correct, actually, data which is I have collected from the system. Okay, I also plotted optimal estimate of Vk which I got after I fitted the model. Okay, you can see that there is significant difference. So you might say, well, is this significant? It's almost explaining everything. Well, I'm also worried about, you know, nitpicking and modeling even this significant or insignificant difference. Okay, my next task is going to be how do I model this funny signal? Can I develop a model? This is coming from unknown sources. Now it has three kinds of errors: measurement error in the transmitter, it has unknown disturbances, third, approximation errors. All three of them are present in this signal. Okay, but you can see the model is good enough, right? I can use this model for control. I don't, you know, if I just have to design a controller, this model is a very good model. It predicts almost everything that is there in the data. There is some minor residual left. Okay, we'll of course worry about modeling that residual, but this is a good model. V of k is difference between measurement and the effect of u on the level. V is everything, measurement noise plus disturbance plus approximation error, everything combined together is V. You want to have that part as small as possible because you are saying that most of it is coming through u. Yeah, so it's a model. So don't confuse a model with a reality. This is a model. This is a model. Is this the correct model? We'll question that. Is output error model, is it a correct model? I'll question that. The next thing I'm going to do is to question, is output error model a good model? Or can I improve upon it? I'm going to do that. Okay.